Well, good morning, everyone. It sounds like you're having way too much fun. No, I love to hear it. The good fellowshipping going on. So grateful that you're here today. Let me welcome you to our worship gathering here at Central this morning. And we're especially glad if you're here and you are a guest, maybe a first-time guest, and we would invite you to take the communication card right there in front of you in the pew. If you would fill that out for us and drop that in the offering boxes located around, there's two or three in the back there that you can drop them in there, and they're in other places too, I believe. But that will give us a way to communicate with you and hopefully answer any questions that you might have. And if you're prepared to give today, we would encourage you to put your gift in that box as well. And if you're watching online, we're grateful for that. And there is a connect card there that we would love for you to fill out so we could know that you are watching and to connect with you. That's our desire. Now, do you have your bulletin with you, your worship guide? I want you to take it and look at a couple of things, okay, before we pray and have a baptism in just a moment. But under general announcements where it says two upcoming mission projects, please notice that there will not be an information meeting tonight. And you say, Pastor Scott, why is that? Because I got to thinking, it's not really necessary. And I don't really like to have meetings that are not necessary. So I've kind of rethought that. But I do need you to do this. The two projects there, one of them concerns an overnight trip to Atlanta where we'd like to take a van load of folks, 15. We've done this several times in the past. It just COVID kind of slowed us down there. But we're kind of cranking this up again, and you'll notice the dates, July 29 to 30, and we can have our own interest meeting right after the service this morning. I'm going to be down front. If you are interested in being involved in that, please come and talk to me about it, and I can give you further details. It's going to be a great time. We're going to partner with two or three other churches here in Tennessee to go down to Atlanta for this mission project. And we're also going to be spending some time with Pastor Kewan Foster, who incidentally is in Cookville this morning preaching at Stephen Street Baptist Church. So I want us to pray for him in a moment as we pray for Brother Roland as well. But then the We Are One event. How many of you were involved in Convoy of Hope last year? Okay, several of you. Well, let me tell you, we need more volunteers. There's more advertisement this year. There's more food. There's more everything. And they want to have at least 1,500 volunteers. And basically, there's a QR code there in the middle, or you can go to that website or text one of those numbers there and sign up and let them know that you are coming. There's no special skills required. Just show up willing to love people. That morning, we'll all meet in the little stadium there at the fairgrounds, and they'll say, we need 50 people to do this, and 50 people will get up and go in that direction. We need 30 people to help with distributing shoes, and they'll go in the other direction. So it'll be great. But we need you to sign up so they can prepare. So that's easy for you there. And then toward the middle of the page under marriage and family ministry, of course, Terry's on a sabbatical right now. And I'm going to be in there on Wednesday nights, the next three Wednesday nights. And this coming Wednesday night, because Kewan is in the area, he is going to be coming and speaking to us about the work in Atlanta. And if you've never heard Kewan, it's an experience, okay? He's a great dude. How many remember the first time that he preached here and he forgot his belt? You remember that? He's a big old boy, and while he was preaching, he was holding his pants the whole time. And I think we presented him with the belt the second time that he came. But he's a lot of fun would love for you to be there Wednesday night. And you'll see what's happening the following Wednesday nights as well. So as we go to prayer this morning, let's remember our mission prayer focus, Mike and Alicia Nichols. And you'll see them listed in the bulletin. Let's pray for Kiwan. Let's pray for Pastor Roland. Let's pray for us today that we would have ears to hear what the Spirit would say to this church. Okay? Bow with me if you would. Father, we stand in great need of you every hour. But Lord, in this hour, we ask that you would bless as only you can. Holy Spirit, we ask that you would work in each of our hearts, each of our lives, that you would have your way with each of us. Lord, we pray that you would do that work of change in our hearts, Lord, that only you can do. Lord, no doubt in a room this size, there may be some here that are in the valley of decision, never have trusted in Jesus as Lord and Savior. I pray that you would quicken their heart even today. Let them know that we love them, are praying for them, not as much as you do, but we desire, Lord, that they would come to know you. And Lord, we know that that's your desire as well. So we pray for those folks and all of us, Lord, we need you. Lord, be with Pastor Roland as he ministers the word to us today. Lord, give him clarity. Lord, fill him just with your power and help us to be attentive. Lord, be with Pastor Kiwan as he preaches in Cookville today. Use our brother there today. Bless them, our sister church. Father, we pray and thank you for Mike and Alicia Nichols. We lift them up in their ministry through Word of Life. Lord, bless, we pray. And Lord, we thank you for Jake Shoemaker and his willingness to follow you in believer's baptism today. Lord, I pray that this would be the first of many steps of obedience in his life. We thank you for him and lift him up and just pray for this time of baptism now. We pray it in Jesus' name. Amen.
Good morning, everyone. As Scott said, this is Jake Shoemaker. His parents are Jeremy and Loretta Shoemaker and Rachel and Jonathan Davis. And so Jake is trusting Jesus as his Savior and wanted to follow through with baptism. We want to remind you that baptism does not save an individual. It's that relationship with Jesus that comes first. And baptism is just a picture of showing what Christ has done in a person's life. And so as we lower Jake into the water, he's being buried with Christ unto death and raised to newness of life because he is trusting Jesus as his Savior. Tucker's here with me to assist because I'm still recovering from surgery and I'm afraid I wouldn't get Jake back out of the water. So we don't want to leave him at the bottom. Jake, is it true that you're trusting Jesus as your Lord and Savior?
Yes.
And what is your confession of faith?
Jesus is Lord.
Jesus is Lord. Amen, amen. All right, it is my privilege then, Jake, to baptize you, my brother, in the name of the Father, and the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Amen. Amen. Let's pray together. Father, we thank you that in obedience, that we follow you, that Jake is following you in believer's baptism. And God, we do ask that you would bless him in his journey of faith. And we pray, Holy Spirit, that amongst us, those that have put their trust and faith in you, God, that they would follow through also with believer's baptism. Father, we know that in the New Testament, you taught us to be obedient. And that is our prayer, that all of us would be obedient to what you'd have us to do in our life. God, thank you that we can begin our worship today with baptism. May we continue to honor and glorify you as we worship you in spirit and truth. And we pray in Jesus' name. Amen.
Good morning, church. Please stand and join us in worship.
Darkness held me down, but Jesus pulled me. goodness of God. I love your voice. You have led me through the fire and in darkest nights. You are close like no other. I've known you as a father, I've known you as a friend, and I have lived in the goodness of God.
Give thanks to the Lord according to his righteousness, and I will sing praise to the name of the Lord Most High. This next song is gratitude.
King, except for a heart singing heart. worship you. So I throw up my hands and praise you again and again. 'Cause all that I have is a hallelujah, a hallelujah. Thy glory is not much, I've nothing else fit for a king, except for a heart singing
may be dismissed to Children's Church. 1 John 1:9 says, if we confess our sins, he is faithful and righteous, so that he will forgive us of our sins and cleanse us from all unrighteousness. This next song is called Clean.
Precious blood has left me forgiven, pure like the whitest of snow, powerful to make sin and shame retreat. This covenant is making me whole, so I will rise and lift up my head, for by his mercy my life was spared. The highest name has set me free. Because of Jesus, my heart is clean. Purify my heart in your presence. Teach me to discover the joy of holiness that forms as you draw me close. In you what was lost is restored. So I will rise and lift up my head, for by His mercy my life was spared. The highest name has set me free. Because of Jesus, my heart is clean. So I will rise and lift up my head, for by His mercy my life was spared. The highest name has set me free. Because of Jesus, my heart is clean. Because of Jesus, my heart is clean.
Let me thank the Perryman sisters for leading us in praise and worship, and I am grateful when young men and women love the Lord and are not ashamed to say so. I hope you'll pray for our teenagers. It's always a challenge in this day and age to live for the Lord. I want you to turn to 1 Corinthians chapter 11. And last time when we thought about this series on authority, we thought about how our spirit gives direction to our soul, who in turn gives direction to our body. Now, we're going to take that concept of authority and just expand it a bit this morning and think about a passage of Scripture, 1 Corinthians chapter 11, that's a very interesting passage of Scripture. You'll see in just a moment. Let's begin in chapter 11, verse 1. I want you to read along with me, if you would, so you'll catch the whole picture. "Be imitators of me," Paul said, "just as I also am of Christ. Now, I praise you because you remember me in everything and hold firmly to the traditions just as I delivered them to you. But I want you to understand that Christ is the head of every man, and the man is the head of a woman, and God is the head of Christ. Every man who has something on his head while praying or prophesying disgraces his head. But every woman who has her head uncovered while praying or prophesying disgraces her head, for she is one and the same as the woman whose head is shaved. For if a woman does not cover her head, let her also have her hair cut off. But if it is disgraceful for a woman to have her hair cut off or her head shaved, let her cover her head. For a man ought not to have his head covered, since he is in the image and glory of God. But the woman is the glory of man. For man does not originate from woman, but woman from man. For indeed, man was not created for the woman's sake, but woman for the man's sake. Therefore, the woman ought to have a symbol of authority on her head because of the angels. However, in the Lord, neither is woman independent of man, nor is man independent of woman. For as the woman originates from the man, so also the man has his birth through the woman. And all things originate from God. Judge for yourselves, is it proper for a woman to pray to God with her head uncovered? Does not even nature itself teach you that if a man has long hair, it's a dishonor to him, but if a woman has long hair, it's a glory to her? For her hair is given to her for a covering. But if one is inclined to be contentious, we have no other practice, nor have the churches of God." Now, I told you it was an interesting passage of Scripture, didn't I? And right now, a lot of heads are spinning. Where is he going with this? Well, you'll see before we over. Now, actually, when I began this message and put together an outline, I had not worked it up. And so I will tell you, we're not going to get to all 5 points of the message this morning. You'll understand that this is an important subject, and I want to be fair to the Scriptures and try to cover some things that I believe the Lord would have us see. But we will be thinking about the first 3 points this morning, and I want you to see, and if you're taking notes or following along in the outline, I want you to see, first of all, the secret of spiritual authority. And secondly, I want you to see the sequence of spiritual authority. And thirdly, the symbol of spiritual authority. We'll cover the last two points, Lord willing, next week, and probably have a little addendum to add to that. I want you to realize that this entire passage, in one way or another, is dealing with spiritual authority. That's what it's all about. And I trust that God's going to give us some insight this morning as we think about this. And so let's just dig in and let's notice, first of all, the secret of spiritual authority. Now, notice in verse 1, Paul said, be imitators. Some translations say, be followers of me, just as I am also of Christ. Now, I praise you because you remember me in everything and hold firmly to the traditions, just as I delivered them to you. Now, in this passage, Paul is exercising spiritual authority. Paul is speaking to the church, and there is the ring of authority and everything he says. You follow me. You imitate me. Remember me. Hold firm to the traditions. And there's no lack of clarity about what he's saying. He is exercising his authority in the church at Corinth. Now, they understood that he was their spiritual authority, and so they were willing to follow, and they did, and he praised them for that. But there was no stuttering here. There's no stammering here. He was very clear, very plain about what he wanted to say. Now, he wasn't like some preachers I've seen who have no sense of authority at all. Paul was their authority. He knew it, and they knew it. And in these two verses about spiritual authority, I want you to be sure and notice the secret of spiritual authority. You're going to find this concept again and again. Now, you remember when we began thinking about authority, we began by a passage in Luke chapter 7. Now, what Paul is saying here is there is a secret to my authority, and it's the very same one that you find in Luke chapter 7. As Paul is declaring his authority as an apostle, he says that is based on his submission as a servant. Now, notice how he said it. You imitate me just as I also imitate Christ. Paul's authority in being over that church was based on his submission to his spiritual authority. And that's the secret that I want you to never forget. You will never be over until you are willing to be under. Now, mark that down plain. Get it down in your heart. You will never be over anything until you are willing to be under your God-given authority. That's just the way it is. Now, I mentioned that Paul had given this secret to us, and it's based on this idea of being over others because you are under someone. Now, in Luke chapter 7, you remember how the centurion sent an envoy to Jesus one day, and they said, Jesus, I have a sick servant, and I want you to come and heal him. And Jesus started that way, but on the way there, the servant said something that was very amazing, very revealing. He sent another envoy to them and said, look, Jesus, you don't even have to come to my house. I know that. And then he said why he knew it. For I too am a man under authority. I say to this one, go, and he goes. I say to this one, come, and he comes. And that centurion was saying, Jesus, I understand how you operate. You are over diseases and demons and death because you are under the authority of your heavenly Father. He said, I understand that because I'm in the army. He understood that as long as he was submissive to his commanding officer, he would be over 100 foot soldiers. You will never be over until you're under. My son-in-law, Eric, was a captain in the Air Force, and he had command over a lot of people under him. But he only had authority as long as he was submissive to his colonel or his general. As long as he was under their authority, he was over many airmen. That's just the way the military works. And this centurion was saying, Jesus, I understand how you operate. I understand how the spiritual realm operates because I'm a man too who's under authority. And do you know what the Bible says that Jesus did in Luke chapter 7? It says he marveled. Now, it doesn't say that very often about the Lord, but he marveled at what was going on. He said, I've never seen faith like this in all of Israel. He marveled at the understanding this man had. And I am trusting and praying that God will give me the ability to communicate to you in these past 2 months and in the next few weeks, however how long they are, for you to get this concept down that if you want spiritual authority in your life, you cannot be a rebel. You must be willing to be submissive to the Lord. That's just the way it is. Paul said, you imitate me as I imitate Christ. Now, if you don't believe that, folks, everything you're involved in is going to be chaotic. Now, 1 Corinthians 14 says God is not the author of confusion. But here Paul is speaking to the church, and he said, I want you to imitate me as I imitate Christ. Now, let me give you a little bit of insight here. I believe as long as any pastor is following the Lord, that church should follow him. And if he is not following the Lord, they should fire him. If he's following the Lord, you follow him. If he's not following the Lord, fire him. Find someone who will. That's the way heaven operates. Now, I have no right to expect you to follow me if I'm not following Jesus. And I'll tell you something, because I understand the accountability that I have before the Lord, if I am not doing my best to walk with him, I have no right to expect you to follow me in anything. And let me say something else about that. If you're not willing to be under your God-given authorities, the devil will laugh at you. He'll mock you. And you may even leave naked. Now, that gets your attention, won't it? Wounded and running. You say, why do you say that? Because there's an interesting story in Acts chapter 19. The Apostle Paul was involved in many miracles. There were a lot of things going on, and you can read about that in chapter 19. But there was a Jewish high priest named Siva. He had 7 sons, and they were impressed with all that was going on. They actually were in the exorcism business. And one day, they came to a demon-possessed man, and they said, we're casting you out in the name of Jesus who Paul preaches. And you know what that demon did? He said, Jesus, I know. And I've heard about Paul too, but who are you? And the Bible says he leaped on them. He didn't just stand back. He jumped on them, overpowered them, subdued them. And the Bible says they ran for their very lives, naked and wounded. I mean, don't you dare sally forth to do battle with the devil if you're not under your God-given authorities. The devil will laugh at you. Now, it is true that we're to have authority over the devil. James chapter 4 says it plainly. Resist the devil and he will flee from you. And we know that, don't we? Amen. But what you may not remember is in that same verse, James chapter 4 verse 7, before it says that, it says, therefore, submit yourselves unto God. Resist the devil and he'll flee from you. Your resisting is based on your submission. And you're not going to have victory over the enemy if you're not under the Lord Jesus. That's just the way the spiritual realm works. Therefore, submit yourselves unto God, resist the devil, and he will flee from you. You know, a lot of husbands have no spiritual authority in their home, and you know why they don't? Because they're in rebellion to the Lord. The Lord has given them clear insight about some things they ought to do, but they don't do it. And they wonder why their children don't respect them, don't want to follow their lead. They wonder why their wives laugh at them in things and have so many times that they don't understand what's going on and rebel against it. You know, there are when you think about a father, yeah, I think about Lot. Lot was a father. And one day he learned that God was about to bring judgment upon the city of Sodom. And do you know what he did? He went to his family first. He said, we've got to get out of here. Now, they had fallen in love with the city of Sodom, and they didn't want to go. As a matter of fact, when Lot talked about judgment of God falling, do you know what the sons-in-law did? They laughed at him. They thought he was a joke. They didn't go with him. They had no respect for the man at all. And you know, because the family was in such chaos because of Lot's leadership, on their way out, his wife turned and looked back. When she was not supposed to, she turned into a pillar of salt. The two daughters were rebellious, and without going into all the details, I would just say that two of the biggest enemies of Israel, the Ammonites and the Moabites, were a result of those two daughters. Now, I'm telling you something. Rebellion against the Lord has trouble, produces trouble in the home. We have some mothers today in churches who wonder why their children don't respect them and why they are rebellious. They have no power in their prayer life. The Bible is a dead book to them. It makes no sense to them. And they're wondering what's going on, but they never seem to understand that they are in rebellion toward God's chain of command. They never get that. We have some youth who are struggling in life, and they can't find victory over some of the things they find on the internet. And they wonder, why in the world can I not live the life that I know I ought to be living? And why can I not do what I want to do and what I know I ought to do? Part of the reason is because they sass mom and dad. They rebel against their leadership, and they look, it seems, for a lot of chances to defy their parents. And they're never going to have victory in their lives either until they learn to be submissive. That's the secret of spiritual authority. You will never be over until you are willing to be under. Now, notice the sequence of spiritual authority. You'll find it in verse 3, and this is where it gets real interesting. But I want you to understand that Christ is the head of every man, and the man is the head of a woman, and God is the head of Christ. Now, there's a divine chain of authority here. And some people don't like this concept. I will be honest with you. Some people rebel at this concept. But God's chain of authority, or if you want to use military terms, his chain of command is simply this. You have God the Father, Christ the Son, the man, the woman, and ultimately the children. We'll see that in a later message. God the Father, God the Son, the man, the woman. Now, in our society, we would say he's a male chauvinist pig. They wouldn't, a lot of people don't like that. As a matter of fact, we would more than likely say, well, he's a misogynist, which is a big fancy word for just meaning that some man who's prejudiced against women. Now, Paul's not prejudiced against women, and it's not misogyny, and it's not being a male chauvinist pig. This week, I noticed that President Carter, Jimmy Carter, and his wife Rosalind celebrated 77 years of marriage, and I congratulate them for that. Man, that's an amazing thing. But I remember a lot of things about Jimmy Carter, and I remember when they asked him about this very passage of Scripture, and he said this. He said, well, that's just a part of the Bible I don't understand, and frankly, that's a part of the Bible I don't accept. Now, that's sad to me. You may not understand it, but when you say, I refuse to accept that, that's a different category altogether. Let me tell you something, folks. The Bible is not a cafeteria line that you walk through and say, well, I like this, I'll have some of that, but none of this authority business. I don't like that. I don't want that. You don't get to pick and choose. You see, you have to decide, is it God's word or is it not? And that's why we began thinking about the authority of God's word and how God some 6,000 times in Scripture says, thus saith the Lord, the word of God says, or he just goes over it again and again and again. Is it God's word or is it not? You have to decide. And if it is, you need to obey it. Those things you don't understand, you pray that God would give you insight, and I believe he will. Now, what is Paul saying? He's saying there's a definite chain of command. And somebody says, well, I don't like that because it makes the woman inferior to the man. No, 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 my friend. Not at all. There is no hint whatsoever of inferiority and superiority in Paul's mind. I don't believe that for a moment. Later on, next week in the second half of the message, we're going to look at Galatians chapter 3. And you'll find that we're all equal in Christ. It's not a matter of inferiority or superiority. It's not even hinted at. And God does not in any way teach that a woman is ever inferior to a man. As a matter of fact, ladies, let me just say this. I believe in many ways you are far superior to men. There are a lot of ways in which I believe women are far. Was that my wife? Okay. Well, it was. Even if it wasn't mine, it was a preacher's wife. Okay. There are a lot of ways. I'll tell you something. Whenever one of our Christian secretaries comes to me and says, you need to be careful here, I listen. I'll tell you, they have a sense of intuition that I don't have. Women are superior in many, many ways. Don't ever think that he's talking about inferiority and superiority. He is not. That's not what he's talking about. But if you're going to say, according to verse 3, women are inferior to men, then by that very same logic, you have to conclude that Jesus is inferior to the Father. I mean, if this verse that teaches the man is the head of the woman, the same verse that teaches that says that the Father is the head of Christ the Son, then if woman is inferior to man, Jesus must be inferior to the Father. And we know theologically that is just not true. Now, I didn't put it in there, but you can turn, if you would, to Philippians chapter 2. I want to share a few verses with you that I think prove this beyond a shadow of a doubt. Notice, if you would, in Luke chapter 2, beginning in verse 5. Have this attitude in yourselves, which was also in Christ Jesus. Now notice verse 6. Who, although he existed in the form of God, did not regard his equality with God a thing to be grasped, or some translations say selfishly hung on to. Now understand that. Jesus is equal to the Father. He is in no way inferior to the Father. He is co-equal, co-eternal with God the Father. But I want you to notice what it goes on to say in verse 7. He emptied himself, taking the form of a bondservant, and being made in the likeness of men, being found in appearance as a man, he humbled himself by becoming obedient to the point of death, even death on a cross. Now, the Bible is teaching here that while Jesus submitted himself to the Father, he was in no way inferior to the Father. He was co-equal, co-eternal with the Father. And let me just say this. The whole point of him saying that is so that, as he said in verse 5, I want you to have this attitude in you that Jesus had. You are never more like Jesus than when you have a submissive spirit. Jesus, co-equal with the Father, humbled himself and became a servant. You're never more like Jesus than when you are willing to humble yourself and become a servant. And I'll tell you, the flip side of that coin is simply this. You're never more like the devil than when you're a rebel. We'll see that in verse 10, but I don't want to get ahead of myself, okay? You're never more like Jesus than when you are submissive, and you're never more like the devil than when you are rebellious. Now, somebody says, well, I don't want to submit. Submitting demeans me. No, 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 my friend. Submitting does not demean you. Look at verse 9 in the same passage. For this reason, what reason? Jesus was submissive. For this reason, God highly exalted him and bestowed on him the name which is above every name. His submission did not demean him, it exalted him. Listen, if you would, to 1 Peter chapter 5, verse 6. Make a note of it in that same passage in your scripture where Peter said, therefore, humble yourselves under the mighty hand of God that he may exalt you at the proper time. You see, when you are submissive, he exalts you. It doesn't demean you to any degree. It exalts you. So don't ever get it in your mind that if you have a submissive attitude that it somehow weakens or demeans you. It does not. But the Bible does indeed teach that there is a chain of authority, a chain of command. The Father, the Son, the husband, the wife. It has nothing to do with inferiority or superiority. But now get this down as well. All Christians are equal in the sight of God, but equality is not sameness. We're all equal, and the Bible teaches that. There are none who are loved more by God or who are worth more to God than you are. The ground around the cross is level. He loves us all equally, but it doesn't mean we're the same. I mean, he made you different from everybody else on the face of the earth. He loves you as much as anybody, but you're not just like everybody. We're not a cookie cutter society. We're all different. And it's certainly true in the spiritual world. Now, we're equal in the sense that God loves us equally. And we're equal in the sense that we're equally valuable to the Lord, but we are not the same. Now, for example, Jeremy Bustler is taller than I am, but I'm a lot smarter in technology than he is. Now, if you know me very well, that should bring a smile to your face. You see, God loves us equally. He may be bigger. He may be smarter. He certainly sings better than me, but don't get puffed up about that, Jeremy. Everybody sings better than me. You know, But we're not the same. But God loves me just as much as he loves Jeremy, though Jeremy can sing better. Though Jeremy is smarter in technology, and I don't want to say too many things because I don't want him to get puffed up. He's still a scuzzball. But anyway, married my daughter when he wasn't worthy. Oh, man. Anybody can... Where is he? Okay. So there is a sequence of authority. Now, the secret of authority is you'll never be over until you're willing to be under. The sequence of authority is this. God in his sovereign wisdom has set up a chain of command. Now, thirdly, think about the symbol of spiritual authority. Now, let's pick up in verse 4, and let's read this again, because this I think is very interesting to all of us. Again, I'm in the wrong chapter, in 1 Corinthians chapter 11, beginning in verse 4. Let me adjust my glasses so I can see. Every man who has something on his head while praying or prophesying disgraces his head. Now, he's not talking about his cranium. He's talking about in the sense that God is the head of Christ. Christ is the head of the man. He disgraces his head if his head is covered. But every woman who has her head uncovered while praying or prophesying disgraces her head, for she's one and the same as the woman whose head is shaved. For if a woman does not cover her head, let her also have her hair cut off. But if it's disgraceful for a woman to have her hair cut off or her head shaved, let her cover her head. For a man ought not to have his head covered, since he's in the image and glory of God, but the woman is the glory of the man. Now, in the Bible, when the Bible talks about a covering, it is a symbol. It is the symbol of authority. It makes sense, doesn't it? The head, normally, unless your arm is stretched out, the head is the tallest part. And if something's over your head, it shows that you are under something. And in this case, under authority. We still do the same thing. I was not in the Marine Corps, but I have friends who were. And they have an eight point cap that they wear. You know what they call it? You better not call it anything else. You know what it is? It's a cover. It's their covering. And I was amazed. You mean you can't call it a cap? No, sir. One Marine told me, you do that and you'll be reprimanded in a heartbeat because it's your cover. Isn't that interesting? A covering. You know what it's saying? Even with that terminology, these men are under authority. Interesting. Even today. Now, as our military goes more and more woke, they may want to get away from that. I don't know. We'll see. But that's the history of it. That's the tradition of it. A military, a Marine Corps cap is a cover. Now, you know, it is a symbol that someone is under something or under someone. That's what a covering is all about. And when a man prays, he's not to cover his head, but a woman is to cover hers. Now, it does not mean, folks, that a man is not under authority. Just because his head is not covered does not mean that he is not under authority. But here's the image, here's the picture. In the home, he is to represent the Lord. He is under the authority of the Lord. And because the Lord's head's not covered, his head is not covered. Think of how Jesus taught us to pray. He didn't say, our great God who is in heaven. You know what he taught us to pray? Our Father. You see, in a home where children are, the biological male is called the Father. Because he, in a very real spiritual sense, represents the Heavenly Father. Now, I know that analogy is heartbreaking for some. If you've had a terrible father, and I have listened to some young women talk about some of the things their father did, and I understand this analogy is great when you have a godly father, but if you don't, it can hurt. And that's one reason, by the way, a lot of people have a hard time with God being a father, because they saw their earthly father. But in this sense, God wanted the man to represent him. He is the father in the home. He's not God. Please understand that, sir. If you think I'm standing here saying you're a little God in the home, you have missed it completely. Man is not a little God in the home. He simply represents what God is to be. Now, It does not mean that he is not under authority. But in order for him to fulfill the symbolism, he doesn't cover his head. Now, I believe, and let me ask you to listen carefully, I believe that many of the problems that we have in America today are the result of shameful and weak-willed men who refuse to take their place, their position. They refuse to be a man. You know, 1 Corinthians also, just a few chapters later, will say, men, act like men. There is a distinction. We're not all just alike. We're all equal in the Lord's eyes, but it does not mean sameness. And I believe that the root of the problem in most homes in America is not with you ladies. I don't even believe it's with the children. I believe the root of the problem in the homes of America, by and large, is the result of the man who fails to live up to what God wants him to be and to be an authority in the home. I believe that with all my heart. And I believe on Judgment Day, he'll have a greater condemnation, ladies, than you, because he didn't do what he was supposed to do. And I'll be honest with you, I understand a lot of women who would say, well, somebody's got to do it. If he's not going to do it, I'll take the lead. I understand that. But it is a shame that so many men will not have the attitude that we find in the Old Testament in Joshua, where he said, but as for me and my house, we will serve the Lord. That's why we have so many problems. Now, the covering spoke of here that she is to wear, to me, seems to be her hair. Now, you can notice in verses 13 through 15, he talks about that specifically. And verse 15 in particularly, it says, for her hair is given to her for a covering. I believe the covering that we're talking about is hair. And if you want to be precise, long hair. Okay? Now, there are other good expositors and men who love the Lord and who are scholars in biblical times and things, who say that it's not necessarily talking about her hair. It may be talking about a veil that women in that area wore at that time. Some would even say it may refer to a hat. And that's one of the reasons in some denominations, not so much in Baptist ones, but in some denominations, you'll see a lot of women wearing hats. And if they don't have a hat, they'll take a scarf or something and they'll put it over their head to fulfill this. Now, I believe he's talking primarily about hair, and that's one of the reasons I think most of us believe that, and that's why all of our women don't have hats on today. But this is one of those places in Scripture, and folks, there are several, but this is one of those places in Scripture where good Bible-believing people will have differences of opinion about what it really means. I have no problem with that. And if a woman feels like she needs to wear a hat, she's welcome to do that. I have no problem with that at all. And I'm certainly not going to sit in judgment over my brothers and sisters in Christ on the way that they cover their head. But this does bring up a problem, doesn't it? Because I'm looking at you and you're looking at me and we're all looking around. Is her hair too short? Is his hair too long? You know, there is a song, literally, in the gospel realm, the Southern gospel realm. I have a copy of it. The name of the song is, if there's hair on your ear, there's sin in your heart. Just saying. But you know, here is the thing. You know, we're looking around saying, well, how long is too long? And don't you dare come to me and say, Pastor, is my hair long enough? Is my hair too short? I will not answer you, because God did not set me up as a judge. Okay? Ladies, God does not say how short is too short and how long is too long. That's between you and the Lord. I'm not your judge. I'm not going to sit in judgment over you. I will leave that to you. My wife has gone through times where her hair is shorter than it is now. She's gone through times when it's longer than it is now. But it's okay. Here's the point, ladies and gentlemen. I believe with all my heart that the Bible and our Lord wants a man to look like a man and a woman to look like a woman. And I think it is a shame when you look at someone and cannot tell. And we see that more and more often. You know, this week in the news, there was a report of a of a man, a 40-year-old man in Philadelphia, who killed 5 people, wounded a bunch of others. But when you go online and look, you'll find him often dressed as a woman. Now, he never said he was transgender, but he does have photos indicating that he certainly has some questions about his own gender. And by the way, if you do your homework, you will realize in the last mass shootings, there are several with people who we would say has gender dysphoria, doesn't know whether he's a man or a woman. We saw it in Nashville, clearly. And that happens regularly. I believe that one of the reasons young people have a hard time deciding if they're a boy or girl is because they've never seen a man who acted like a man and a woman who acted like a woman. They grow up in some homes that are so politically correct that these kids don't see it. No wonder they're confused. It gives me a pain I cannot locate. But it's mostly all over. I believe that this whole business of gender dysphoria is devilish. You're welcome to disagree with me if you want, but I believe that. And I believe the reason so many kids are having a hard time deciding, am I a boy or a girl, is because they've never seen a man who wanted to be a godly man. And they've never seen a mother who wanted to be a godly mother. It's no coincidence, ladies and gentlemen, that as the respect and adherence to Christianity and Christian principles decrease, that we see a breakdown in the home. It's devilish. Next week, Lord willing, we're going to look at some of the things that are being taught in our society and some of the groups and some of the things that they say. There is a plan. It's not by accident that the home is falling apart. It is a planned thing. No wonder kids are wondering, what am I? You know, the Bible says when God made them, he made them male and female. And you know what he did after that? On the day after day, he looks at what he created in Genesis chapter 1. He said, it's good, it's good. And on the day that he created the man and the woman, do you know what he said? It's very good. Notice that. Very good. We're not the same. We're different. And to that, I would say, viva la difference. I am so glad. I don't want to spend my life living it with somebody just like me. That's why I chose Phyllis. She's nothing like me, you know? It's not the sameness that brings us together. It's the differences that bring us together. Opposites do attract, like magnets. Opposites attract. And it was the differences that I saw in Phyllis that attracted me to her. I'm glad we're not just alike. We're not all alike. Now, you may come to your own different conclusions about some of these things. But I want you to know unequivocally where I stand in this thing. This is what I believe. And I think it was important enough to the Apostle Paul that he spent several verses talking about it. There are differences. And there is a chain of command. And you're going to have to decide where you come down in this thing. But it is no wonder to me at all that we see our society disintegrating. What is shocking still to me is that adults would want to inflict that on little children. Who are 5 years old or younger. And they, through the drugs that we give and the surgeries that we perform, man, listen, you talk to we have a pediatrician here this morning. He gave me a thing not long ago that says, you know, that a teenager cannot think straight till they're in their early 20s. No wonder teenagers are so confused. Their brain's not finished, you know. It's growing. And we laugh, but it's true. It's true, the mind matures in the early 20s, not as a teenager, and certainly not as a 5-year-old. What are we doing in this country to our children? And again, I say, it's by design, and it's devilish. Now, all this begins, folks, with submitting to authority. That's what we're talking about. And until you're willing to submit to authority, you're never going to be saved. You don't confess Jesus as just a good teacher and a great leader, though he was both of those things. But you heard in the baptistry this morning, what is our confession of faith? Jesus is Lord, boss, ruler, king. You call it what you want to, but Jesus is Lord. And when we become a Christian, we choose to follow him as our Lord and Savior. God gave us several institutions: the home, human government, the church. You know what the primary function of each is? To teach you to learn to be submissive, because if you don't, you will never be a believer. You'll not be a rebel and march into heaven. Doesn't work that way. And it may just be that some of you have never been willing to submit yourselves to the Lord Jesus. You know what? Today would be a good day to do that. It'll be a great day for you when you choose to follow Jesus and let him call the shots in your life. Let him decide where you go, what you do, how you think. And I'll tell you something. As the days roll by, we're becoming more and more of a minority. And you're going to find that you're going to be a fish swimming against the stream. Because at one point, our nation would encourage these things, but not so much anymore. As a matter of fact, you may even be blamed for the problems in America. I scratch my head and wonder, how did we get to this point? But that's where we are. Now again, back to you. Have you ever submitted yourself to him? Have you ever come to him and said, Lord, I want to follow you. I want to be an imitator of you. Like Paul said, I want to be like you. I want to follow you. You want to submit yourself to him? You can do that right now. And I hope that you will. Let's bow our heads for a moment. Heads bowed and eyes closed. Heavenly Father, I thank you for the truthfulness of your scriptures. And I pray, Father, that right now you'd have your way in every heart, that you would touch hearts and lives that perhaps have never been touched before, that they would understand they are a rebel. If they're going to be like you, they're going to have to learn to be submissive, because you came to this earth in a submissive format. I pray, Father, you'd have your way in every heart right now. And should there be some who need to make a decision, I pray that right now you'd lead them to do that. Let's slip to our feet quietly, reverently, heads bowed, eyes closed. You praying. If you'd like to make a decision for the Lord, you come. You come right now, realizing the world may not appreciate it, but the Bible says there'll be rejoicing in heaven when you choose him. You may not excite this nation, but you can excite the Lord by your choosing to follow him. Would you right now make that decision for him? Our staff is down front. They'll be here to talk to you about the Lord, to lead you in that decision. People are praying for you right now. But that decision is yours. They can't make it for you. Mom and dad can't make it for you. Your children can't make it for you. Only you can make that decision. And right now is a good time to do that, to choose to follow Jesus. There's still time. The best decision I ever made was one day in church, deciding to walk down that aisle and give my heart to Christ. I will forever be grateful for that decision, because it's affected everything in my life since then. you come now and lead us in our closing time of praise.
So I will rise and lift up my head, for by His mercy my life was spared. The highest name has set me free. Because of Jesus, my heart is clean. So I will rise and lift up my head, for by His mercy my life was spared. The highest name has set me free. Because of Jesus, my heart is clean. So I will rise and lift up my head, for by His mercy my life was spared. The highest name has set me free. Because of Jesus, my heart is clean. Because of Jesus, my heart is clean. Because of Jesus, my heart is clean.
As you're blessed this morning, go and bless others.